a very, very important day for Jammu and Kashmir, also for the country as a whole. The bifurcation of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh has taken place. Well, joining us now for his views on the significance of what has taken place, the road ahead. Is it going to be a peaceful road ahead? Is it going to be one which is challenging? Nirmal Singh, the former Deputy Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir. Sir, thanks very much for being with us. The right to information, the right to education, Panchayati Raj institutions, the rights of Hindus and Sikhs as minority communities, this is all going to change now. There are going to be rules now, rules which govern us across the country, which are now going to impact Ladakh and the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Do you really believe that this is going to enhance or bring together the state more than it is presently?
Of course, because it has been done for that purpose only. And we were deprived of all those things which were explaining just now. Because in Jammu and Kashmir, there were certain laws which were of medieval in nature. They have gone. Now new laws, passed by the parliament, they have been extended to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. For example, the rights of the women. Because earlier, the daughters of the soil who were being married outside, they were not enjoying rights over here.
Yeah.
Same is the case with the minorities here. Because here, the majority was the minority. The tribals, most of them, they are basically Muslim, Gujjar and Bakrawal. They were deprived of their political rights in Jammu and Kashmir.
But sir, how would you respond?
They shall be extended to the state of Jammu.
Sure, Kashmir. But how would you respond, sir, to those who say that this essentially fulfills an ideological agenda of the Sangh Parivar? For example, Manish Tiwari of the Congress has tweeted, "Multicultural crown of India, Jammu and Kashmir has been dismembered for ideological reasons. Hindu Jammu, Muslim Kashmir, Buddhist Ladakh, fused into one entity, represent the quintessence of the idea of India." He seems to suggest that that notion of India has been changed by this ideological decision. How would you respond to that?
This is one of very unfortunate that Manish Tiwari, who is an advocate of the Supreme Court, is saying like this. He must know the history of Jammu and Kashmir. He must understand the demography of Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir. Kashmir is Muslim and Jammu is a Hindu. That's true. But they are together. Same is the case with Ladakh. In Kargil, they are Muslims. In Leh, they are Buddhists. They are living together. They are together. So, how this the cultural, pluralism will go? With the form, this is a political arrangement, which is temporary. It has been promised on the floor of the parliament that ultimately Jammu and Kashmir is going to be the full state.
Okay.
So that's Manish Tiwari has no other argument to put forth. And so they are creating confusion. This is very unfortunate.
So, sir, this decision has taken place on the birth anniversary of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. The Prime Minister has spoken on how this is a move towards the unity of the country. However, the Congress party, for its part in the past, has said that it's not right for the BJP to misuse or to usurp, in a sense, the identity or the legacy of the Sardar. They've actually said that, they posted a picture with Nehru, reminded the BJP that he was against the RSS. So to say that today is the right occasion, again, it's not ideologically correct, is what the Congress seems to suggest.
Congress, unfortunately, is being run by this Nehru Parivar only, where they don't have any place for Sardar Patel, who was a person who united India. He is the architect of modern India. And in that modern India, the Jammu and Kashmir was left behind. Now, Modi ji, the Prime Minister, Amit Shah ji has done it. Now, it was the right time to pay homage to Sardar Patel by integrating Jammu and Kashmir to the Indian Union. That is the tribute which has been given to Sardar Patel.
Okay.
If they claim that he was a Congress person, then they should have done it. But okay. What is their stand in the parliament? But when this re-organization...
Sir, these are, of course, political perspectives. You have yours, the opposition might have theirs. But in terms of what people, for example, people in the Kashmir Valley feel at a time when mainstream opposition leaders in Kashmir are still under detention, when the political process has not kick-started quite in the manner that it should, and people in Jammu and Kashmir, certainly parts of the Kashmir Valley, would say our identity, our territory, it's changed, it looks differently now, our political rights no longer exist at this stage at which they were a few months back. Is this a very happy day for them?
It's a transitional system. Because no identity has been disturbed, we shall get our rights. But these people who are behind the bars, what they were speaking earlier, that if somebody touches this Article 370, not only hands, but even bodies shall burn. What were the statements of Dr. Farooq Abdullah and Mr. Amr Abdullah? So ultimately, when the government decided to abrogate Article 370, definitely they wanted that there should not be any disturbance. And these people, they were creating chaos and disorder by misleading the people of Kashmir. So that was to be done to maintain law and order.
But sir, ultimately, how are they creating disorder if they had no idea of the decision to remove Article 370? They had no idea that it was going to take place. So how did you know they're going to create disorder?
But you have their statements even before 5th August. What they were saying? They were instigating the people.
How were they instigating the people if they had no idea what was going to take place? I'm just curious to understand.
They were.
They may have been. They were politically opposed to it. If and that's their birthright, sir. We all have political views. But how could you be so sure that they were going to instigate violence?
They were their these people, their representatives. They did it in the parliament. Congress MPs, National Conference MPs, PDP MPs. They spoke there, and that's the right place to express the opinion.
Okay,
but
so one last question:
the people by giving violent statements.
One last question, sir. Do you believe now that this move has taken place that in a very finite period of time, political leaders in the state, and it's not just the Mehbooba Muftis or the Omar Abdullahs, but so many hundreds of others who are detained, they will be let out, and that the political process in Jammu and Kashmir from the grassroots level can be revived. Are you optimistic of that happening sooner than later?
Yeah, of course. We hope that it's done as early as possible, but these people, they have to behave responsibly. They shall not be allowed to instigate the people. Whatever has been done, that has been done. And nobody can undo that. If they do like this, as they were doing earlier, they shall be dealt under law. So same is the case with the rest of the people.
So if there is political dissent, once they come out, they go right back to jail. That's what you're suggesting.
They have every right to speak within the constitutional framework, within the framework of law, but not preach violence,
sure.
Not preach separatism. They shall,
right.
That shall not be allowed.
Okay, well, they are nationalist parties at the end of the day. I'm not quite sure whether they'd agree that that they preach separatism. But thank you so much, sir. I think bottom line is we have a new political reality in India, a new set of laws in terms of what Ladakhis and people in Jammu Kashmir would have. It's going to be a big change, and hopefully a change which is peaceful more than anything else, sir. Thank you very much for speaking to us.